Good evening and welcome to another edition of Harmonics. Today I got a legendary band with me, and I've got the great legendary band member himself, the original, Robbie Dunbar. How are you, sir?
I'm doing fine, Greg.
The new vocalist, Johnny O'Day. And of course, the bank, Ralph Bankus. How are you guys?
Great.
How are you doing, man?
Man, I am so glad that you guys are here today, man.
Thank you.
Robbie, how does it feel to be with this new band of players?
It feels great. These guys were fans of the original Earthquake and are great players in their own right. So being with them has been great energy just right from the start. In the last 2 years, we started forming these into this year.
It's a pleasure. I've seen you guys live, and you're fantastic. I'm going to move over to Johnny O'Day, because I've known John for a while. Truly one of the great vocalists in this area. I should say Northern California, California. Let's go all over the place you sang, yeah. John. John, you're with Earthquake, with Robbie.
Yes.
And also the bank, Ralph. Is that, if you don't mind that, Ralph.
Ralphie B, baby.
Tell me what it's like. Let's first talk about your CD.
Okay.
And then we'll talk a little bit about Earthquake, what it means to you to be an Earthquake right now.
Okay. About 2 years ago, I got out of my writer's funk and I started writing songs again. I just woke up one morning. I told my wife, go get my guitar. It was like 8:30 on a Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. And she brought me the guitar and I had this song in my head. It was a song about my dad. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. And she helped me out with the writing and stuff, but you know, basically she was writing down what I was telling her to, you know. Mm-hmm. And we wrote in about 20 minutes, you know, 15 minutes. And so I thought to myself, wow, man, I can write again. You know, I had this
metal
funk for so long, and then you know, I hadn't performed for a long time. So I just kind of gave up a little bit, you know, just kind of put it aside and thought, you know, if I ever get to feeling where I want to do it again, I will, you know. But I had my own business at the time and everything. So I had a lot of stuff that was, you know, keeping me from relaxing enough to clear my mind to write some songs. And so anyway, that opened the door. And so I pretty much just thought, okay, let's see if I can write another one. Okay, sounds good. Let's see if I can write another one. My wife's going, wow, you know. And so, you know, I got about 5 tunes together and talked to a friend of mine who had a record label. And to make a long story short, we disagreed on some things. And so we parted. And I just thought, I'm just going to do it on my own. Mm-hmm. So I looked around for a little bit, asked a few people. Everybody I asked was willing to help me and everything, but I live so far away now. I finally got a hold of Tommy Mary, who's...
Tommy Mary, great guitar player from Gamma.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
He was my guitar player in Air Raid many years ago. Big Bay Area band. We were pretty popular.
Right.
And he was telling me, well, I'm in Gamma, you know, but we're down right now. We're not doing much. So I said, can we get together and I'll show you? So he called me about 2 days later and said, can you find me a place to live up there for 2 months? And we'll do the album up there. And I said, all right, absolutely. So I called one person who knew another person. Go.
Cool.
Before I knew it, he was up there.
You did the album.
What was it?
What's the name of the album?
The album's called Johnny O'Day, Audacious.
And you should see the cover. Cover's really good.
Steven Giuliano.
It's audacious.
Steven Giuliano did the cover. He was in a lot of Bay Area bands. I Am Ghost.
Yeah, he did a lot of work.
Yeah. And a lot of people don't know. He's a great artist and computer artist. And stuff.
Oh, yes, yes.
So he, you know, really did me a favor by doing this and took good care of us because, you know, he's got a strong connection with Tommy.
Right.
They've done a lot of work together.
Right.
And he actually came in and helped out with our video.
Right. Over at, what is it, Soundwave?
Soundwave over in Oakland.
Yeah, Soundwave. Yeah. Let's give a great crew,
we
great
so
bunch of guys.
Fun.
Yeah, those
guys
are good. It was fun.
Yeah,
really,
it definitely really shows it. It definitely shows it. Let me go change a little bit of that. Ralph the Bank, man. They call you Ralphie B, but I call you the Bank, man. You're just so solid. You played with David Flaman back in the day, didn't you?
Well, yeah.
And a lot of other bands.
Yeah, I did. I've known Robbie a long time. And if you look up history, my band that formed out of It's a Beautiful Day called Natural Act, Earthquake followed us at the Troubadour. They followed us at the Whiskey A Go-Go. Mm-hmm. We followed them at Keystone Berkeley, but really didn't get to know each other. Mm-hmm. And then I've always played, and it's so great to play in a band with original music. because the writing of the music is really what makes the soul of the band. It's the foundation.
Yes.
And Robbie and I, we do play in a lot of different cover bands with great, great musicians, but just takes it to another level just because the music itself is still so solid.
Right.
So it's, I kind of happened this by accident. Robbie was at the house. He asked me to sit in with one of his bands. I think we did a tribute to David Bowie, some little drum thing. And the next thing you know, here we are, and the energy's great.
You're an Earthquake.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I'll turn over to Robbie, man. Robbie, you got really two very distinguished musicians in the band.
Yes.
And being who you are, I mean, you came out of an era in the mid-70s. You had, you know, you had Dave Medichetti from Y&T. You had Jimmy Lyons. You had Vince Black. All these different guitar players. You had a very distinct... People really respected you, and we respect you even more
now. I feel it from then. I feel it all since then, mm-hmm. And I was so lucky that we could form a band. For me, it was like being in the eighth grade. It was called Purple Earthquake, and it was a time when Berkeley had all these free Provo Park, yes, across from Berkeley High concerts every Sunday, and so we would open up for like Steve Miller. Some people know Linda Tillery was her band.
I was
going to
say The Loading
Zone.
We opened up for her.
Yeah, and so many different bands. And as time went on, somebody found us at Provo Park for A&M Records. We ended up going to L.A. right after Berkeley High School for me. And by that time, we had John Dukas on vocals, Stan Miller on the bass, Steve Nelson on the drums, and myself on guitar. And just, you know, recorded at the studios where... Dare I say, the Carpenters were like the king act there in L.A. Mm-hmm. And the A&M, Jerry Moss said, you guys are great. You've done two albums. You can stay with us, or if you want to start your own label. So we started Berserkly Records instead. And it was just so much fun. The scene in Berkeley, Rather Ripped Records, was the record store.
Sure was.
And we started playing... We had taken a club called the Babylon and tore the walls down, and it became the Long Branch. And so we were like the kings of the Long Branch.
You were.
And there were the other Berserkly bands, like my brother's
King,
band.
The Rubinos.
The Rubinos, yep. Mm-hmm. And Greg Kinn. And I played on the street with Greg Kinn for a considerable length of time till he needed a drummer and a bass player, Larry Lynch, Steve Wright. And so that really became the Berserkly group of bands, and Jonathan Richman as well from the Modern Lovers. But so playing all these years and playing on these Bill Graham shows, Winterland, A Day on the Green, we opened for Edgar Winter. And a fun story was Bill Graham comes to us with a bowl of chopped chicken liver. He says, you guys are the chopped chicken liver because you're the opening act, but someday you will be the brisket. So just keep playing hard, Earthquake. And
sounds
so, you know, and that's that thing about being in the scene around the Bay Area then. Mm-hmm. It was a great time to be playing
music. Great time. You know, I'm gonna go over to John because John's a vocalist. What does it mean to be with Robbie and, you know, and be the vocalist of a legendary band? Walk into the shoes of John Dukas, but you really, as a vocalist myself, you created your own vibe, which is absolutely great. Tell me about it.
It was great. It was like a dream come true. It's like Robbie and I got a hold of each other on Facebook. And
good tool.
So he invited me down to watch his band play down in, where was that, in El Cerrito?
Yeah, the Kensington Circus
Pub. And so I told him, he said, you want to sing Saving My Love? And I said, that's my favorite song. But before that, I had talked to him about using that song on my album. But the problem was it didn't sound much like anything that was on my album. So Tommy was producing it. He said, why don't we save that one for another time? And so I said, okay. So, but anyway, I went down and jammed with Robbie's band down there. And after we got done, he goes, you passed the audition. And I said, what do you want me to sing in your band? He goes, well, yeah, you know, we got four singers, you know, maybe, you know, we'll. And I said, well, you know what? You guys got a great band. You guys got four different singers.
Right.
You don't need me.
That's Aftershock.
Yeah, Aftershock.
Oh, okay.
And I almost forgot. But so anyway, I said, I'll tell you what, if you do Earthquake again, I said, I'd love to do that with you. And he said, wow, because I've been thinking about it. So we talked after that, and he talked to some of the guys in the band. We were just going to see which guys wanted to be in on it, which guys had time. It just kind of came out to where, okay, we got a rehearsal place. Let's go do it, you know.
It's great. So, it is absolutely great. You guys are great on stage. The Bank, you were actually the timekeeper. I love watching you play. I got up real close when you guys were playing out at the Fremont. What was your influence and what makes you tick in this band? Because you got a great array of Jimmy the Jet, and then you got Mr. London himself. Let's not forget those gentlemen.
Right.
But you got Jimmy the Jet as your rhythm section, and also Lions, and I know also he's playing. There's a section where you guys are just all playing together. It's like a locomotive, mm-hmm. just moving mm-hmm. through. What is it like to back these guys?
Well, it's definitely a privilege. I mean, it was almost like being into a built-in band with great original material. You had two guys that have played for years, and Jimmy and Robbie, and they know each other.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, that's a gift to a drummer. Most and Jimmy's definitely. A very, very strong bass player. Most and definitely. Robbie can play his butt off. We all know that.
Mm-hmm.
Then on the other part of the band, you have two guys that have played together a really long time as well. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of the odd man in. But it just fit really, really good. I mean, the song has structure from the old guys that played it great, but I still have the freedom to put my own, you know, my own deal to it, and you can just play by feel. And so it's pretty much of a privilege and a hell of a lot of fun to be able to just to kick them in the butt. Robbie's the musical leader, no doubt about it. The writer, but this guy here is really the stage captain, okay? Right. He's really, really the stage captain, and we give each other plenty of room without taking it too far. I think as we play even longer together, we'll probably even take it a little bit farther and get to the cliff, because that's kind of fun of music and the material lends itself to it.
Right. You know, you said an interesting thing right there. You give each other room to breathe. And that's what I noticed on when you first started. He's the guy that is actually, the first thing he does, he gets on the mic. Johnny got on the mic, and immediately he engaged the audience.
Yeah.
And he gave him an immediate compliment. So right there and then, he already grasps it. 25 to 50% of the group right there, he grabbed it. Then all of a sudden, you just came on like an avalanche, and you guys opened up, which I've always liked that you guys did. You open up with Route 66.
That's a great song.
You know, one of the great songs.
Yeah.
Robbie, like, are you guys going to... I know you guys did a video, and you guys look great, because I actually got to see it. Thanks to John, because we talk a lot. We talk probably at least once a week now, which is a good thing.
Nice.
Tell me, what are you guys going to start writing? Because I know you got great writers right here, all in here.
Yeah, we have fragments of ideas, mm-hmm. and even bigger than fragments.
Mm-hmm.
And Johnny had one where he woke up from a dream, and I wrote it out because I write, calligraphy. And I'm a literate musician that way, so I was able to write down Johnny's dream idea. And it was actually a dedication to John Dukas.
Right.
Wow, that's beautiful.
This one's for the Duke.
Mm-hmm.
Or I was saying, doing it for the Duke.
Mm-hmm.
And, Gary Phillips.
Another great musician.
Grabbing it for Gary and stealing it for Steve Nelson.
Yeah, there you go.
And pounding it for the Pounder, which is what... Stan Miller was called as a bass player
of
the original band. But here's this band is a great team. And that's what I hear you guys talking about is, you know, giving each other room, but we're all on this team.
Mm-hmm.
And you can feel that between everybody's great affection for each other.
It's such a great musical respect. So let's talk about the scene today, because it's a lot different than it was.
Oh, yeah.
I was making more money back then than when I do a gig now. You know what I mean? Yeah, exactly.
And they take taxes out.
Yeah, you gotta sell tickets or whatever.
Right.
What is your interpretation of, you know, you guys did some great shows just recently with Gamma, or one or two shows with Gamma. What are you looking for the scene? And I'm going to go right down the line here. Robbie, what are you looking for as a musician now?
I'm looking
now?
For the right person to represent us, both from clubs that are fun to play around the Bay Area, and then some of the larger venues. It could be like Mountain Winery, it could be like Tahoe, just the greater Bay Area and Northern California for starters. I mean, and of course we would travel to LA, you know, Las Vegas, anywhere. But that's kind of the primary first focus.
So John, we same kind of question. In this band, what are you actually looking for? I know you guys are going to start like the Fragments. When you said a dream, it reminded me of like Keith Richards when he did Satisfaction, or when McCartney wrote Yesterday, but he called it Scrambled Eggs. What are you looking forward to in this dynamic band that you're in, this legendary band led by Robbie? And of course, you guys are Earthquake. So what are you looking for?
Number one is I just love to play live. I love to entertain, you know, and following
and
you're
good
in Duke's.
At it, man.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Following in Duke's footsteps, you know, like one of our old friends said, you got some big shoes to fill. And Robbie said he knows how to fill them. He's got his own shoes. So, you know, it just makes me feel so good to be able to sing these tunes, man. I mean,
you can see it.
Boning up for these gigs, I was listening to them over and over again. That's the way I memorize.
You got the nuances, and you've made them your own.
Yeah. Yes, you're absolutely correct.
I tried to stay, you know, with what he did, the recognizable stuff, but also, you know, put a little of my own stuff in, you know, my own stage presence. You know, John moved around a lot on stage, a lot of jumps, a lot of arm John movements, you know.
Metal belt.
Big smile.
John was great.
He had a huge smile, you know, that's on the cover of the live album, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, I just feel so proud to be able to carry on, to carry the torch for the rest of the guys, and, you know, and to move into a new era of Earthquake, writing some tunes that are still relevant to the old times, but a little newer too.
Yeah, you're going into new musical landscapes and territory. You know, I'm gonna quote a little song for you, David Lee Roth. You got the sensible shoes, brother. You know, because you're the guy now. You're the mover.
Right,
Ralph. I asked you earlier, who is some of your like a drummer? I was looking at you, and you throw down all kinds of different chops. Who was some of your influence growing up? Who was your influence?
Oh boy, the normal guys. You know, the Beatles changed a lot of our lives, right? Without them, I would not be in you know, Berkeley, California. I'd still be in New Jersey. I love New Jersey. I just wanted to grow up and get out. But the shore scene down there was fantastic. Obviously, Steve Nelson, he played a lot like Keith Moon. He was in a band called The Who with our friend Alan Chan, and he's got those licks completely, completely down. He was probably one of the best rock drummers that ever lived. I think a great ensemble drummer is probably a guy by the name of Steve Gadd. And I think out of this band, again, I think the material is so solid, it's really hard to do original music. I mean, exactly. I got to make that clear. It's really, really hard. But to have this type of material that people can still bite and stick their teeth into, if we just get some great audiences or a good partner band where we could, you know, partner with and play occasionally up and down the coast would be, you know, absolutely tremendous thing. And I can't forget Charlie Watts, too.
Oh, Charlie was
good. I was wondering.
One of the best. Yeah, man. Charlie, you got to give it up.
One of my drum sets is exactly like his. Okay?
Oh, that's true. Charlie Watts is probably one of my favorite drummers. Everybody goes, he just plays on the hi-hat. Please, 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 you know.
Yeah. Solid as a rock.
Solid as a rock.
His hand never plays on the 2 and 4 either.
No, he does, yeah. He's so distinguished. You know his beat.
Yeah.
Johnny, as a vocalist, I know you play guitar, but as a vocalist, that's your presence on the stage.
Right.
Who were some of your influence as a vocalist when you were growing
up? Oh, wow. There's so many. I mean,
just name a couple.
I would say Sammy Hagar, you know.
Good choice.
Up front, you
good
know,
choice.
Right up to the top there. Duke, you know, I used to watch him at Winterland, man, and the guy was just incredible.
He could perform. Oh,
he would be just proud of the stage, you know. Paul Rodgers. David Lee Roth. I love David Lee Roth. You know, I loved the way he, you know, again, the front man stuff.
He was the Mac Daddy at one time. He was,
I mean,
he
you know,
was
he took it a little far, but, you know, you learn from all these guys. Right. I mean, the more you listen to them, the more you watch them, you take little bits and pieces of that when you're creating your own style. Exactly. And being in cover bands, you know, I didn't do a lot of cover band stuff when I first started out. And I started doing it more in the late 80s. And being in cover bands and you start duplicating people's music, you start gaining little things your in knowledge. Your own style from that too. You know that.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
You've been singing the blues for your hard rock. Time,
yeah, hard know, rock and
blues, that. Everything. You know.
You take and give, and then you all of a sudden it's you. And that's what's great about what you guys are doing. Mr. Dunbar, man, you've been a great guitarist for a long time. I've always admired you from afar, seen you play, been on stage with you. Who was your influence? And when did you first start playing guitar?
When he was two.
No, that was the piano.
That's like my grandson Luke.
My mom was my piano teacher at about age three in Levittown, New York. And it was funny how I started playing the guitar in the winter of 64. And then like, I don't know how many days later, the Beatles came on Ed Sullivan. And then I knew what a guitar was for. And I had already training in piano and trumpet and all that kind of East Coast where you were in competitions and you wear, you know, your white shirt and do all that.
Of course.
But it was the whole British invasion and then moving that summer of 64. I always call it the year of the Beatles. But I'd seen the Stones at Carnegie Hall.
Great.
So, you know, I bring like the visceral enjoyment of those two bands and then everybody else. But Jeff Beck... seeing a Sunday afternoon with the Yardbirds at Fillmore. Then, like, of course, Jimi Hendrix and The Who the same week. Eric Clapton. I mean, I could go on and on about these bands, but if I stop right there, we have enough. They're very important influences on what became Earthquake.
It, you know what, and it tells, and if you look at some of the old pictures of Robbie, don't you just think he's the coolest? He had the shades on, you know, had, you know, you could just see him up there. He always has that kind of a stance, and he always is in that little, he's always in the pocket. You're always in the pocket.
Thank you.
You know, and you know what, you guys got a great band. Bank, I love watching you play. Johnny, man, you're like a brother to me, man. It's
Thank
just,
you.
I'm so proud of you guys getting together and making it all happen. Hopefully Blue Voodoo and us could get together. We could get to a show. And, you know, I want to thank Robbie and John and the Bank himself. We call him Ralphie, but I call him the Bank, man, because he's just, he just brings it to me, man. So I'm going to invite you guys back again.
Great.
You know, maybe about 6 months, maybe a year, see where you guys are all at. But it's been a pleasure, Robbie.
Thanks so much.
It's been totally a pleasure. And maybe we can do it again. Yeah, thank you.
Sure.
So one of the things that we do, we actually kiss our audience because we got a lot of ladies out there to watch our show. So I'd like to thank Earthquake for coming today. Robbie Dunbar, here's a nice kiss. Peace and love to you.
Monday morning feels so bad. Everybody seems to nag me. Coming Tuesday, I feel better.